I request Mr. B.V.R. Mohan Reddy, Executive Chairman, CN, to kindly come onto the dais and chair the next panel, and as well give the keynote address.
So very good morning to all of you. My name is Mohan Reddy, and I have the role of being Executive Chairman of SINT. And truly, I think what my company does and what we are proposing to do today are very synonymous of each other. You'd find it very strange that we actually have a division within our company which is called Design-Led Manufacturing. We have a business unit which does that. So therefore, when my good friends from ICM invited me to come here for IESA, I-E-S-A, that's how you pronounce this, Venkat? ICM. And I thought it would be a privilege for me to be here with you this morning. And I met with, of course, two surprises this morning. Both were very positive surprises. Or I'm not so sure they're very positive, but the second one made sure that the first one got covered. Strangely, Indigo came very late, which is very unusual. It came an hour late today. But the biggest surprise which made the positive life to me is that Bangalore traffic brought me from the airport to the hotel in an hour and 20 minutes. So that's how life will, you'll have both pluses and minuses. So we should give some credit to Mr. Deshpande. I believe he talked all about how the infrastructure is improving. Mr. Babeja, who is also a very dear friend of mine, didn't have so many positive things. But that's real life, I think, on the ground at this point of time. So as I said, consistent with what we have as a theme of building India's strategic electronic ecosystem for great self-reliance and global relevance, this particular theme for today is going to be on, for this 1 hour, on design-led manufacturing. What I will do is, I have four panel speakers, but for their benefit, because they could probably see the presentation much better by being sitting on the other side rather than this side, we thought we'll bring them onto the dais in a few minutes. But let me set the tone for today's presentation or today's discussion. If somebody can help me put my presentation up there. Yes, I can. So therefore, the first and the foremost I have is, there you are, is the need for building a strategic ecosystem for greater self-reliance and, where's the computer? Yeah. What's the need is the first and the foremost issue that we have. And as far as the need is concerned, I think this is not something, anything new to many of you who are here, is that we have a tremendous amount of increase in our import bill. People are predicting at this point of time that by 2020 it could go as high as $400 billion. Whereas the domestic production probably would be somewhere in the range of $100 billion, which means that there's a need for, there will be a need for as much as $300 billion. I'm sure this is fairly often repeated that if we continue in this mode, our electronics import bill could even overtake the oil bill by 2020. The second one is that we're finding that security becomes an extremely critical issue for any nation. As Prime Minister Modi said, wars of the future will be fought without bloodbath. You don't require to see blood at all. You go and hack into the system, and then you would find that everything is gone. So the result is, in this digital world, security becomes extremely important. And there could be consequences which are unimaginable if you don't think about security as a key driver for the nation. And the third one is, we live in a new world called the digital world. Digital Darwinism is taking all over us. And truly, the government of India also put in play the Digital India Initiative. But what it will mean to all of us here, not only it's a great opportunity, but also there's a need for more amount of electronic equipment, electronic hardware. Electronic hardware, which is just not Digital India, the associated ecosystem that comes by, whether it's in defense electronics or it's consumer electronics, we will require more and more amount of electronics. So therefore, there is an enormous amount of need for us to become self-relevant. The next thing is, then why are we not so self-reliant so far? What are the challenges that we faced so far in this country? It's certainly, I guess, we did not lay enough of emphasis on technology. We all the time either we imported technology. Actually, in the 1980s, I used to run a hardware company for 10 years. And in the lighter vein, people used to joke at us, saying that we all do what is called a screwdriver technology. And very honestly, the cost of importing components in a knockdown condition used to be more expensive than getting equipment in fully assembled situation. Fully assembled, tested equipment was cheaper compared to getting components because the volumes were not there. So we all got accustomed to this environment of saying, even if we build systems in this country, these were systems largely which had technology from elsewhere. And the second one is that we continue to have this big burden on us in terms of ease of doing business. No denying things are improving. We now have a bankruptcy law in the recent past. They're saying, you know, they put together a number of portals in which we can go and log ourselves in to make sure that we don't need to go and file those 150 or 180 different forms in the country. The ease of doing business is improving for sure, but all the same, that's the bigger challenge that we had. And associated with that is that we haven't been in a position to attract a great amount of foreign direct investment. Foreign direct investment and productivity all over the world are very directly connected with each other. You have global investments coming in, they demand global productivity to go along with it. So it's a combination of these three things: our inability to have in-house R&D, not only in the private sector, we'll come to the public sector too in a minute, or the government sector. Government created these large labs, all right, but one always have a big question mark in front of them. In terms of what is the productivity that's coming out of it. Is it outcome-based research that they do, or it's research for research's sake is what I keep saying. So the end result is that because of these challenges, we still remain in an arena where there is enormous amount of need for us to build our own ecosystem, which will make us self-sufficient and globally relevant. So what's the solution I have? And I'm sure this is a solution many of you think, and this is what I speak to a number of decision makers in this country, is a solution is in this area called design-led manufacturing. What, actually, to that extent that I feel very delighted, when originally Make in India came into existence, when the current government 24 months back used to speak about it, it was more about Make in India, was all about manufacturing India. To me, Make in India is not manufacturing India. If manufacturing India, we go back to the same situation what we were in the 1980s, and literally getting also very close to a bankruptcy as a nation by 1991, 1992. If we were to definitely want to make this country self-sufficient, we have to innovate in India, we have to design in India, we certainly have to manufacture in India, and equally important is that we have to support this equipment in India. So what I mean by innovate in India, how do we get to innovate in India, is that we got to definitely ensure that we have a culture of innovation in this country. And how does culture of innovation comes into existence? Start challenging the status quo. If you continue to say this is how things will work, there's no innovation that will come by. Our ability to take risks has to increase. our ability to work as teams, we'll talk about the ecosystem, public, private sector, the academia, the government, the policy makers, all of them working as teams is something which will then deliver a innovative solution to all of us. And finally, get an idea and pursue it to the end. But the timing today for innovation is at its best. Why? Because the disruption in terms of technology couldn't have been any better than what it is today. I keep saying the velocity of change in terms of technology has never been seen by mankind so far as what it is today. Of course, coupled with that is you also have enormous amount of uncertainty. So this uncertainty with the disruption that's happening today creates lots of opportunities. There's no denying the existing players who are also very well established, great players. Four of them will come onto the dais in a few minutes from now. But we will see opportunities coming up for new entrants, which will certainly change the landscape of this nation. Every disruption in the world that we have seen has only brought about good changes. They lifted the economic viability of nations if they embraced technology. That's how Europe became so strong after the Second Industrial Revolution and the Second World War. And so did, you know, US embrace technology, and that's how they're so strong. That's how developed nations are. So if you embrace the new technology that's on, which is the disruptive in nature, which is, you know, whether a number of technologies which are coming by, and I don't know what more will come by. In one breath, I can talk about SMAC, IoT, artificial intelligence, deep learning, 3D printing, and so on and so forth. But there's a lot more that will come in. So there is time is opportune for this nation to innovate because of the disruption that you have in this world, in technology. The other thing is, if innovation has to happen, we need to create the ecosystem. The ecosystem is for one of the things that we've been talking very intensely from the NASSCOM perspective is creating the centers of excellence. There's one we created in Bangalore, which is called the IoT Center of Excellence, Internet of Things. I'm sure that could be a major disruptive technology which can change the societies itself. It can have a social impact at this point of time. So we should create more amount of them in order to see that we have more amount of depth, in-depth knowledge, and an ecosystem to create products around new technologies. So also, we require more amount of startup ecosystem because startups is the future of this world. And we don't, in this country, especially in India, we don't recognize them and realize them. I don't know how many of you are aware that 60% of new jobs that are created in even the Western world today are created by startups, small and medium companies. Only 40% of the jobs get created by large corporations. So therefore, and startups are innovation hubs for this, for any country for that matter. So we need to promote more amount of innovation by promoting startups. And finally, you also need to make sure that what you created as innovation is protected well. That's what I would call it as protection of IP. The next thing that we need to do is we need to design these products here. Just innovation is just getting ideation. Ideation has then to be designed. It has to be engineered. And the good news that we have is there's tremendous amount of skill in this country for doing that. There are 8,000 ER&D centers in India. 600 of them, which are locally grown, 400 of them are multinational users. Multinationals have their own development centers, which are called GDCs, Global Development Centers, and they're all located all around the country, and a bulk of them, of course, in Bangalore. And these ER&D centers employ as many as 200,000 engineers. And I can assure you that one after the other, if we talk to many of these, which I do, of course, and I'm one of them, all right, we're doing leading edge design work for customers all around the world. whether it's the best gas turbine engine that had to be designed in the world, it was a substantial part of the design was done in India by Indian engineers. I'm sure my friends from industry who are going to be on the podium now will also give you examples of what they are doing. So therefore, there is already a talent that is available at this point of time, which is doing R&D work. And so also, there is tremendous amount of labs that are available which can do research in this country, which can do the design and engineering thereafter. Hundreds of CSIR labs. You want to take a guess how much of money government spends on CSIR labs right now? Anybody wants to take a guess? The budget for CSIR labs? It's 7,000 to 8,000 crores, a billion to billion point one every year. That's the money that gets spent out. The other day we went and asked them this question, what have you done in the last 60 years of independent India? I got a book finally from them. I only like two things. The first one was, I should give them credit. One was, there's a tractor that is produced in India from a company called Tefe. That was a design that was done by them. Or I believe now they have some laser technology centric distance measuring equipment, which is being used in airports, airport landing systems. Great two ideas. But we have 100 CSIR labs working for 60 years. In between, there was some more material, but I was telling the minister concerned that we should have had this voluminous books for each CSIR lab saying that this is the technology they produced. So we have that still intact in the sense the labs are there, the scientists are there. It's a question of how do we use them. And the third one that I also want to do is that government has to definitely ensure that the investment increases in R&D. In India today, if you look at it, 80% of government R&D, 20% from private sector. But you look at that 80%, it's a minuscule of a total percentage. Percentages-wise, they will be misleading to you. Whereas in US, if you look at it, it's the other way around, 70% for private sector, 30% by government, but in a large piece it is. So if you want to continue with this design-led manufacturing strategy, the third thing that has to be done is we have to do design, and we have those skills in India, whether it is the ER&D centers or the laboratories of the government, we do have that capability within India. A third thing that I would say is that make in India is manufacture in India, that part of it. And I'm going to close it in a minute. So job creation. And job creation is something which is very critical for us in the sense that today in the ability to do jobs, people who graduate with a degree, we get a million of them every month into streets of India. A million of them, that's 10 lakhs. Every year, we get 10 million, that's 1 crore. In the next 10 years, we get 10 crores of them into the streets of India. They have to be gainfully employed. And they require, so therefore you have that resource, but you need the skill to go along with it. So long as we can make sure that the skilling is done, the infrastructure can be improved, we certainly can make in India, notwithstanding the fact that ease of doing business has to improve. So therefore, the make, to me, make in India or manufacture in India, it's not synonymous with each other, the manufacturing India part of it is also feasible in India. And finally, the fourth one that I'd like to point out to you is that we need to also have the ability to support products. Many products fail because, you know, we don't create that infrastructure to support them. If you don't have that infrastructure to support a product, the product doesn't live longer. And especially in areas like defense electronics, where the cycle times in terms of developing a product is long, and equally important is the lifetime of a product in the field is very long, unless you have the ability to support it aftermarket, then what happens is it'll be the same thing, that you have a foreign supplier who comes and handles it for us. So do not, therefore, neglect the aftermarket support, and we need to create that local support, which is feasible. So to sum it up, what I think is that we have to definitely look at technology absorption and provide more amount of momentum to our startups. the R&D investments that the government has made has to catalyze into outcomes. We have to move more into intellectual property protection, ease of doing business, improve this infrastructure. But equally important is the fact that we have to have skilling in specialized domains. This is the overall picture I have. So which is, to me, I'm setting up saying that it's very critical for us. We have had challenges, but here's a great opportunity. If you can innovate, design, manufacture, and support, you have a win-win for both the doer as well as the nation at the end. What we did further was to set up a panel for you today. I'll invite the four panel members. The first among the list I have here in front of me is Mr. Anoop Ray, who is the Vice President of Axis CADIS, Axis CADIS Engineering Technologies. Please, Anoop. I'll then invite Mr. Ashok Bhaveja, who was the Chairman and Managing Director of HAL, who is now the Head of Quest Global Defense. And our third panelist is Mr. D. Umamaheshwar, who is the Executive Chief Consulting Engineer for GE Aviation India. And then we'll have Mr. C.P. Suresh, who is the General Manager of Technology Planning at Bell Bangalore. So the format for the panel discussion would be that I'll first request my panelists to make brief remarks for about 5 minutes each. And then we will open the floor for question and answers from every one of you. I like this session to be more interactive. So therefore, please be prepared to ask the panel, and I'm also a part of the panel, so ask me questions. So thank you. With that, I'll now request Arup to come in.